Will China be a better trading partner than the traditional trading partners?
You know, trade is trade. Mm-hmm. And anyone always looks for a best deal, whether it's China, whether it's Japan, whether it's America, or whether it's Europe. But what is important is, as a buyer-seller, you must always take care of your interests.
You have not quite answered the question, Your Excellency.
I've answered.
You don't know whether China will be a better trading partner. I'm asking because China is now big in Angola, and a lot of African writers are pointing to the fact that China is coming in. But there are those who think that China is not really coming in for good, and that China comes in to develop infrastructure, does not transfer technology, etc., etc. So Africa should continue to look at the old trading partners. And I'm asking whether, from your experience and expertise, you have a view on this matter.
Well, we must always watch for the downside of any trade arrangement we have or any cooperation. I think we are playing smart, and that's why I said, in any deal, you must watch for your interests, whether it's China, whether it's Europe. As Africa, we must watch for our interests. But let me give you an example of what I've seen, the arrangement between China and Africa. First of all, because of their presence, we've been able to reduce quite a bit of the conditionalities, because China doesn't come with the conditionalities like we used to have, mm-hmm. that would be governance or macroeconomic policy or governance of any nature. Now, that is another matter. The second aspect is the time frame. If you sit down today with China to negotiate a port construction or road construction, I bet within a year you will see production or construction on the road. But if it is any of these multilateral or developed countries, negotiations sometimes take 4 or 5 years. Mm. The project parameters change, and if interest rates was going to be 10%, after 4 years, add that to the cost of the project, and you started construction of this within 6 months, you're better off with this fast track. Mm. But as you talked about technology, China is a developing country, but has that willingness to share. If you look at China, China has stood with Africa and has continued to stand with Africa during decolonization. I lived in Zambia for a long time. When Zambia was trying to support the countries of Southern Africa against apartheid, it is China that came to assist them in construction of what you call Tazara. Mm-hmm. And at that time, if you went to China, it cost almost 25% or 30% of Chinese government revenue to come and construct that rail. Now, that is because China itself saw a long-term interest, but also was assisting the countries because it could not accept the principle of apartheid as it was being practiced. Now that we have this framework of cooperation with China, we sit around the table and we do inform China of some of the downside of cooperation with them. As you mentioned, for instance, the transfer of technology. If it's construction, you will see it's Chinese equipment, Chinese staff, and so we need to start to have a mechanism that we can also cooperate in the area of transfer of technology.
AGOA is the African Growth and Opportunities Act, and it's been around for over a decade now. Has it benefited Africa in revenue? I know that Mauritius has been has benefited tremendously from that, and to some extent Botswana as well. But are there other great examples that we can show from AGOA?
The examples are largely limited to textiles. Mm-hmm. And as you mentioned, a number of countries, I know Kenya, Lesotho, in addition to what you mentioned, Madagascar, that also benefited from the textile industry export to the United States. A few other countries are starting to export agricultural products, but because of distance and transport costs, we cannot compete producers from South America who are just backyard economies of the United States. So it's very difficult for us to compete in selling the US market. In fact, I always say that if you look at AGOA, perhaps the US has benefited more than Africa, because now US is diversifying its energy sources from other parts of the world to Africa. If you look at the amount of energy imports from Africa, US is now almost reaching 20-30%. So that has been the kind of relationship on AGOA. And that's what we should leverage, that this relationship must be mutually beneficial. We have asked for AGOA that it should be extended, but it must also be investment friendly. We must start to see investments, not necessarily procurement of energy from Africa. And we must also start to see other benefits like technical assistance that really could help Africa bridge the gap, particularly in the area of transport, to develop transport sector, ships that can take African commodities to the US market. US must also relax in a number of areas, like in agricultural products, where there is a lot of bureaucracy for us to be able to export to the US. So those are the issues that we should be able to address in AGOA.
Food production is another big issue. There's been famine in Africa this year, and food production is important to get citizens to be well fed so they can think and assert their civic rights, which you talked about in stabilizing governance and democracy. Is food production a big part of your plan?
It is. In fact, we have within Africa what we call Comprehensive Africa Agricultural Development Program, CADEP. This program was initiated way back in 2003 with a number of parameters where governments committed themselves that they must spend at least 10% of their national budgets to be able to produce enough food. Secondly, the way the CADEP is designed, it brings to the table all the stakeholders, the producers, farm associations, cooperatives or partners that may be there in government, where you identify opportunities, challenges that beset the sector and agree on an action plan to address those. So far, we have close to 30 countries that are now starting to follow this frame of cooperation. And there is also regional compacts that have been produced. I'm aware that in ECOWAS, we now have a regional compact. We have seen even the private sector, because of this openness that now you can have government and private sector cooperation, starting to come forward to look at investment opportunities in agriculture. And so, yes, in short, food production is part of that program, is very much central program of the African Union, and is something that we should pursue, because as you said, there has been famine in Africa. But that famine, in some cases, is beyond really what you might call the local capacity and capability. It is informed by climate change. In the Horn of Africa, where there was a famine, for your information, the worst famine in 60 years. But if you go back to record, you will see rainfall failed to come for almost 4 years continuously. In the same region now, it's raining very heavy. And so with the climate change, we're going to be seeing this. So one of the issues that under agriculture we must address is move away from rain-fed and many other factors about food production.
So if an African child is born today, Your Excellency, what can you say about how he would see Africa when he's 10 years old?
A changing Africa. When I look back to my own time, growing up, I never even knew the next village because communication was very difficult. Today with ICT, I have grown-up children, they're no longer children. The other day, in fact on this Sunday, I had a nephew of mine who's 12 years old. He had a compact, iPad, and he was teaching me. I don't consider myself computer literate, but when I look at this 12-year, who is so knowledgeable, cannot compare with myself when I was 10 years old. And when I look at these young people now growing, if we expose them, these are the ones who are going to be in Tahrir Square to challenge you if you are a leader tomorrow and you are not performing, because they cannot wait. And so we must prepare ourselves to put our economies in a way that they can absorb these young people coming. Africa is a very young continent. The average age of the continent is less than 30 years old. In many parts of the world, it's much higher than that. So we must prepare our economies to absorb this, but also give them space to operate. That is the future I see for the continent.
Thank you, Your Excellency. Thank you for your time. It's a pleasure talking to you. Thank you, viewers, for watching. The future is bright. Let's be optimistic. Bye-bye.